Greetings, everyone, and welcome to the mother of all Keeping America Strong with Horror Movies edition of Monster Party.
Monster Party!
It's huge! It's creaturistic! It's fantastic! It's
saving America with what we love.
It's life-changing.
Yes.
Life-changing.
Yes, it is. It changed our lives. It made us who we are. The monster kids who took over this tiny part of the world.
And speaking of monster kids, who are you, sir?
I am Matt Weinhold.
I am Sean Sheridan.
I'm Larry Stroth.
And I'm James Gonis.
And for this episode, I will not be introducing the topic. I think this needs to go to Larry Stroth.
I just want to get right to it, guys. I have to tell you, this is an absolute dream come true for me. Tonight's guest and topic, he's a reporter who's interviewed thousands of celebrities. He's an accomplished author with many books like The Monster Movie Game, Bogart 48, World War III, The Creature Features Movie Guide.
Yay!
Revenge of the Creature Features Movie Guide.
Yay!
Creature Features Strikes Again Movie Guide. Yes, and my personal favorite, I Was a TV Horror Host.
Yay!
Yes, he's a producer, writer, director of the 1977 classic Nightmare in Blood.
A classic.
Guys, he's a historian, a teacher, and for over 6 years, was the popular host of KTVU's Creature Features in the San Francisco Bay Area from about 78 to 1984. Folks, it is my honor to welcome to the Monster Party podcast, Mr. John Stanley.
John Stanley!
Thank you so much. You remember me better than I can remember myself.
Oh, man, you're like another parent. You were like that cool parent that I went to late at night. It's like, hey, what are we really going to do tonight?
No, John, you've been a part of Creature Features for years. Actually, you were actually a part of Creature Features before you actually were a host. How did you get involved with Creature Features and Bob Wilkins and that whole thing?
Well, you know, when you look back on your history, it's amazing how you did something and that kind of changed your life and moved things in another direction. And then suddenly other things started to erupt out of that change. Mm-hmm. Every time you take a step, you just never know what's going to happen next. What happened was with Bob Wilkins, I had worked at the Chronicle from 1960. I had started as a copy boy. And in less than a year, I had a full-time writing job on this World magazine. And inside This World was the entertainment section, the Sunday date book. And that's really what I wanted to write for. And it was just a series of lucky events that led to that. So to go from there, I have to move myself from San Francisco to Pacifica, California, 20 miles from downtown San Francisco. That's where my wife and I moved in 1967. I didn't know that Bob Wilkins was on KCRA Channel 3 in Sacramento. We didn't get that station on our antenna TV, but now we needed cable. And for some reason, we had just a few stations, but KCRA was one of those stations. And so I discovered Bob Wilkins one Saturday night. And I very soon after contacted him. I wanted to give him some information about a movie that he was going to show soon.
Oh, cool.
Or whatever he had talked about in the last show that led me to maybe I can help him out a little bit, because at the Chronicle, I had begun reviewing major science fiction, fantasy, and horror books, and also individuals who made these films. I was even reviewing, not on a full-time basis, but I was reviewing films every so often for John Wasserman. I don't know if you remember him or not.
I do, yes.
Yeah.
John Wasserman.
Why do I remember the date?
Very unusual talent. He used to call me at 3 o'clock in the morning on Friday morning and say, there's a movie opening at a certain theater tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock. I want you to review it and have the review written by 4 o'clock and meet all the deadlines.
Jeez,
and the review would be in the Saturday paper.
No.
Fantastic.
Oh my gosh.
That was an unusual part of the Chronicle. Anyway, our relationship with my relationship with Bob Wilkins continued with phone calls, with letters, but we never met until I got a phone call one afternoon at the paper from Judith Morgan Jennings. She was the publicist for Channel 2, KTVU, owned by the Cox sisters. Mm-hmm. And I had gotten to know her very well. There was a thing called Operation Prime Time. Do any of you remember that?
Vaguely familiar.
Yeah.
Independent TV stations all over the country would donate money into a particular place, and all that money would be spent to make a feature film. But only the stations that paid for it could play it. It was a unique situation where Channel 2 had an original movie to play that had never been shown before to the Bay Area.
Sounds very Canadian.
So Judith Morgan Jennings called me to say that Bob Wilkins was coming from Sacramento to KTVU. He would start on Saturday night on the first Saturday of January 1971. So I immediately said, I want to interview Bob because I think it'll make a great story.
Yeah.
And we did. We met for the first time. He came to San Francisco. And the Sunday before the first show, there was a major story in the Sunday date book, the pink section, about Bob Wilkins. And that was the beginning for me in the Chronicle anyway. Mm-hmm. Well, it wasn't long before Bob invited me to be a guest on his show. Yeah. I had made a short 16mm film called Homecoming, a Fable, which was a fantasy horror film. It actually played in some film festivals over in Europe.
Wow.
And it was the first amateur film that Bob played on Creature Features. Wow. He would play many more over the years. In fact, when I took over the show, I devoted two full programs to nothing but amateur films that had been continually sent in.
That's cool.
Yeah. Cool.
To me to take a look at.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, then there was the Monster Movie Game.
Yeah.
And Bob formed a panel.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
I remember seeing this.
I was one of those on the panel.
Oh, yeah. My God.
And we had a quiz.
Yeah,
we had a television quiz.
That's like dream come true. Yeah. That's awesome.
I had a lot of money running on that thing.
Well, anyway, I started writing some books. I think you quoted Bogart 48 and
World War III.
My World War III. Originally, it was Napalm Sunday. But
I like that
the publisher felt that was a little anti-religious. Bob would have me as a guest on the show and so on. And then I actually produced a film. The title was Nightmare in Blood, and we filmed on Bob's set.
Yeah,
we filmed several sequences on Bob's set. Film didn't come out for a while. The film finally made it in 1978. That was Bob's last year doing Creature Features.
Mm.
And what was interesting, what I loved about the movie, it told you what had happened in the comic book industry. We had a character who was based on a character who had written a book, anti-comic book. Mm-hmm. So we had a character based on him who's on Bob's show talking about how comic books are destroying America and that sort of thing. Yeah. We also had Gary Arlington. Do you remember Gary Arlington? He opened the first comic book store in San Francisco in 1966.
Is that the comic book store that you use in the film?
No, we used a different setting. Uh-huh. We had to build a set.
Okay.
It looks great. It looks like the real thing.
Yeah, it looked like the real thing. And we dressed the Gary Arlington character in a religious-like robe.
That's why he was
a priest.
That's why you did that.
That's awesome.
I like with the Captain Marvel lightning bolt.
That's right. Yeah.
Great stuff.
That was the one and only feature film that I was ever able to do.
Yeah, it's really a fun
Bob
movie too.
Bob was in it. There's a sequence where he's in.
And he's in the crowd. John, I love how you have Bob in it, but also when you're on the creature feature set, two things stuck out at me. Number one, the horror host that's there, who's actually kind of mean, right behind him is a Frankenstein bust that had been on the show. And when I saw that, I flipped out because that's the same bust that came up for auction at the Profiles in History auction a couple of years ago. And I'm thinking, no one knows about this. I'm going to bid on it. Yeah. And what happened? Kirk Hammett, damn him. He outbid. it's in his collection. I'm just saying, it's in his collection now. Right. But the coffin.
Future guest. Hey,
yes, I know Kirk. But John,
he's
John,
a great fan.
Yeah, but he outbid me, so I can hate on it. But John, the coffin.
My sympathy.
Yeah, the coffin in the background still exists. The coffin is now at Time Tunnel Toys in downtown San Jose.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Joe and Sharon Castro.
Is that the coffin that has the head on it?
No, it's not the vampire coffin. It's the coffin on the creature feature
set. Right.
On the creature feature set. That coffin was preserved and it's now at a store in San Jose. And they actually have like pictures of you and Bob Wilkins and like a little plaque. It's so great.
Is it true that your dad made the vampire coffin?
Yes, that's true. My father,
that's awesome.
Stanley.
That's very unique
hardwood
coffin.
Floor layer. Yeah.
Man.
In fact, he taught me the business when I was 10 years old. I had to go with him every Saturday and every holiday or any time I wasn't at school. In fact, he would have come at 3 o'clock and pick me up at school and we'd drive a few blocks to a house where he was laying the hardwood floors. I'm 16, he said to me, a father and son hardwood floor company. I said, Dad, I've had enough sawdust blow into my face. No, I don't want to do that. I want to go. I wanted to work at a newspaper. I wanted to be a writer.
Thank God you went that path.
Yeah. And that coffin, by the way, is beautiful.
Yeah.
It's really unique.
It's really cool. It's very unique.
He does excellent work.
Great. He created so many of his own original ducks, you know, three-dimensional sized, and he was a real artist.
So did he ever say to you, all right, John, well, if that newspaper thing or that TV thing doesn't work out, you can come back and work on the floors with me? Did he always have that open to you?
Well, I continued to work with my dad whenever I would come home. I came to San Francisco to work there, but sometimes on weekends I'd be free. Mm-hmm. I'd go to Napa Valley where he lived, and I would work with him for a couple of days. And that continued until he finally had a heart attack and finally had to stop all of that.
Wow.
And that's when he shifted over to doing the three-dimensional ducks and creating his own rifles. He would design his own rifle stock.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow.
He was very, very creative.
Yeah. Well, I have to say that I really enjoy Nightmare in Blood because it's a film obviously made by horror fans and horror lovers.
Yeah.
You treat the material respectively, but also kind of do it, you know, you have fun with like the tropes of the vampire films and things, and there's little in jokes everywhere. But it's actually also like a competently made horror film. There's the vampire characters, great Malachi.
Yeah. The actor.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was wonderful. And I'm sorry to say he died just a few months after the film was released.
Wow.
Yeah. Jerry Walter.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's terrific. Yeah.
He was in a lot of small parts in Streets of San Francisco and other television shows. And
you got great character actors too, like High Pike.
High Pike. He was wonderful.
And you have Kerwin Matthews in the beginning, in the little prologue.
Oh. He was working.
How did you get Kerwin Matthews?
He was working in a store in San Francisco.
No.
Yes. And we found out about this. He had retired from movies. And we went into the store and we told him we wanted to, we'd already edited the movie, but we had made some changes and we were going to have a new beginning, which was going to be scenes from a movie.
Right.
Starring Malachi, the main actor.
Right.
A character. And he agreed to do it. I said, it will only be one day of shooting. Mm-hmm. We're going to do it next to the plaza of the Golden Gate Bridge, you know, where you go through the
really
do the Pape Plaza.
Yeah, yeah.
It was right opposite there, a few feet, a few hundred feet away. And that's cool. We had a guillotine we set up there.
Yeah, nice.
Of course.
And it looked like this poor young woman was going to be killed. And so...
hard to get a permit.
Kerwin Matthews is the hero who comes in and destroys Malachi.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think the guillotine should have just stayed there. I think that would have been a nice little thing as you've gone onto the Golden Gate Bridge. Oh, look at the guillotine over there. But the store, he was an antique salesman, wasn't he? Or an antique
It could have been an antique store. Yes. I believe it was. Yeah.
But he looked great. Yeah. He still looks heroic.
Yeah. Yeah. He was perfect for that role. He was wonderful. Yeah.
That's a great movie within the movie.
Yeah.
But John, how long did it take you, though? You said it took you years when you started.
Well, we filmed it in 1973, and in 74, we found a distributor, and we thought we were going to come out by 76, but the distributor went through some monetary problems and finally told us they couldn't distribute the film, but we didn't have to pay them for the extra costs we had incurred. So when we did find another distributor, we didn't have to pay. I think it was almost $100,000.
Wow.
The original distributor just accepted that. But didn't worry about it. So the film finally was released in 1978. And then it came out on VHS a few years later. And then in 2005, Nightmare and Blood became a high-quality DVD.
Nice.
And you saw it in the scope it was shot in. It was shot in a special cinema scope kind of thing.
Right.
You made a few bucks. You made a few bucks from this, right?
A few bucks. Yeah. Didn't get rich.
But what I love about the movie too is that aside from being this love letter to horror fans and monster kids and the idea of having a real vampire at a horror convention. What I also love is some of the twists that you include, like the Jewish vampire hunter.
Yeah, that's great.
Originally is hunting Nazis.
Irving Israel was an excellent actor.
Oh, yeah.
I had known him for many years. Yeah, and he played the Avenger. We called him the Avenger. And he's aware of how Malachi had cooperated with Hitler in the destruction of the Jewish race.
Yeah, that's a great
idea.
During
World War II.
Yeah.
That's some heady stuff. That's some nice, deep, heady stuff.
Pretty graphic footage about that.
Yeah.
And then also throwing in things like there's this wonderful conversation that they're all having on the stage about, you know, the problems that a modern vampire would have to go through. The environment affects the blood. And that was all really great stuff, especially for anybody who's looking for anything different from your standard vampire tropes.
Yeah. I'm glad you're bringing all that up. It all happened so many years ago.
was it a challenge?
The co-writer was Ken Davis. Yeah. Ken Davis was an artist who did many. He did many sketches for my movie guide series.
Oh, cool.
In fact, I have a new book I'm working on. I took a collection of those A to Z sketches he did. And there are 7 or 8 pages in the book of nothing but Ken Davis's.
Oh, nice.
From A to Z.
Oh, that's great.
This one has a letter in it, but then the visual goes with that letter, like B is Batman or.
X is the character, right? It starts with that letter.
C is a killer cat or.
Nice.
Ken and I also wrote some books together. He was really a wonderful artist, and I want to pay tribute to him.
Yeah.
And that will be in my new book, The Career That Dripped with Horror.
Nice. The Career That Dripped with Horror. I like that.
I hope it's out early next year.
Okay.
We'll have interviews with Christopher Reeve, who played Superman.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay.
With Noel Neal, who played Lois Lane in the serials, Superman serials.
Right. Yeah.
The list goes on and on. Ray Bradbury's in the book and Robert Block, and each one gets into the psychology of how you write your horror stories, how
nice
psycho or whatever they are. Both are really unusual interviews because they seem to really get into the mind of each. and how they write their stories. And I didn't realize that until after it was all over with. And I read the stories again and I said, I think these are going to be very, very unusual to go in the book, you know.
That's awesome.
Well, and your interviews were always stellar, right? And the fact that you did so many of them between, you know, your reporting and then on Creature Features.
Yes.
Do you have some that really stick out in your mind as well?
Your favorites?
That favorites or maybe not so favorite?
Leonard Nimoy will always be one of those that sticks out in your mind. Yes, he was in San Francisco doing a play, a one-man play called Theo. Mm-hmm. That was the brother of Vincent Van Gogh.
I remember. I remember that. Yeah.
And I interviewed him for the Chronicle and I said, gee, Leonard, I'd love if you would be a guest on my show. And he said, sure.
Wow.
When he heard it was a horror science fiction series I was doing.
Uh-huh.
So I'm not quite sure how, but a few fans found out that he was going to be a guest on the show.
Uh-oh.
It kind of slipped out. Maybe I mentioned it the week before. I'm just not sure. But a few fans, maybe only a dozen, showed up that morning. They knew we taped on Friday morning.
Mm-hmm.
And Leonard's limousine pulled up and suddenly it backed up. And instead of him just coming out and walking in, it went around to the back to the delivery.
Yeah.
And he rushed inside looking for my wife, Erica, who was my producer. She was always taking care of things before a show. And he said, there's a woman outside in the front. And if she comes into this building to be part of what's going on here, I will not do the show.
Oh, wow.
It's like some overzealous fan.
That woman, every night she shows up at the theater where I'm doing the play.
Oh, no.
She's in the front row and she's staring at me.
Oh, no.
I just can't stand the sight of her.
Wow.
So my wife rushed to find me and told me what was wrong. So I went out to the front. I said, I'm awfully sorry, but we have a rule that we can't let fans in into the studio. We're not equipped for that, which was kind of true.
Right.
Although we could have managed to, you know, take care of it if we had to. So except for a couple of the guys, I said, wait here, don't go. They all left.
Right.
Then I was able to get the other two guys into the control room where they could watch the show as it was being photographed.
Oh, well, nice.
It's funny, Matt, I don't know if you remember, but you could always tell when John had a very special guest, because for listeners on John's Creature Feature show, John had this very regal, spooky, but comfortable chair.
Yeah, it's like a throne almost.
Yes, it's like a throne. And next to him was like a coffin that guests would sit on. But if he had a special guest, they had a special chair. Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah.
And Nimoy was in the special soft chair. Remember, oh, man, they're going all out for Nimoy.
I remember Patrick Wayne, the son of John Wayne.
Oh, yes.
Was my guest. And his father had died just a short time before that.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is 1980.
Yeah.
And he saw the coffin and he says, I really don't want to sit on that.
Sure.
So we got the chair for him.
Right.
Yeah. But I had to do that occasionally for a special guest.
Yeah. We would have begged to sit on the coffin.
Oh, I would have.
We would have wanted to come out of it like our guests. And then.
But, you know,
there's another guest. His name was Christopher Lee.
Special chair.
I got to interview him when he did The Man with the Golden Gun. And that was just a story for the Chronicle.
Yeah.
But then he was making a motion picture over in Marin County in late 1979.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just going to get a new set. They were designing a new set for me.
Yep.
And it was, I think, in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So a Star Wars group with all the people in costumes of the characters were there that morning to go through the motions like they were going to build my new set. And they were carrying hammers and saws. And
yes.
We had pieces of lumber. And I would duck down when the lumber went over my head. So it was all kind of a joke, you know. Here are these Star Wars people building me my new set. And you're going to see it in a couple of weeks.
That's cool.
Hey, man, I'm sorry. I bought it. I thought you had people dressed up building the damn set. I mean,
Well, I have sound effects, hammers, saws, you know, drills. <That's> anyway, great. My guest was supposed to be Christopher Lee.
Right.
Okay. I had three segments set up. I had all the questions. I had film clips, stills, photo stills. Everything was all set. Well, he hadn't arrived at the time he was supposed to, so I could explain to him what's going on here. So he walks in to the studio as I'm in the middle of doing this thing about building a new set with the Star Wars people. And he looks at that and he decides this is utter nonsense. And he turns to my wife, Erica, who's standing by the door. I don't think this is the kind of TV show I want to be associated with.
Wow.
He turns and he's going to walk out the door. And over the door is a monitor.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm in the process of now introducing the end of the segment, which is an interview with Ray Bradbury. It's a first of a two-part interview. So I'm introducing that, and then the interview runs, and Christopher stands there and watches the whole thing. The lights come on. I have finished the segment. He turns to Erica and he says, "Well, I guess if it's good enough for Ray Bradbury, it's good enough for me."
Oh,
nice. Shade, he didn't
my
leave.
God.
That's great.
Otherwise, I would have had a show with no guest. I don't know what I would have done. Anyway, a number of years later, in 1984, there was a show in San Jose in which Christopher was invited to be one of the guests, and I was able to interview him up on the stage that day. Ray Harryhausen was there also.
Wow.
And he had to fly back to London, but Christopher Lee said, "I don't have to go anywhere, so why don't you and your wife join me for dinner?"
Oh,
my gosh.
Nice. Wow.
And had the most wonderful dinner. And it was sort of just a relax and enjoy the moment and be.
That's amazing.
Wonderful actor, the Hammer film star.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
So once you got past that moment, he was lovely from that point on.
He was perfect. He was fine.
Wow. Well, John, I think you're such a good interviewer, but you also know your stuff and you have the love and respect for the material and the things that these actors do. So I can see why. I'm sure Christopher Lee watched you with Ray Bradbury and go, "Oh, okay, this guy is actually the real thing."
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure he could see that. He could sense that. Yes. Yeah.
Now, John, you took the show Creature Features over from Bob Wilkins. Now, Bob Wilkins started to do Creature Features and he kind of had a very dry sense of humor and he didn't dress up like a ghoul. He didn't dress up in a costume.
No, he had no costume at all.
No.
Right.
But he had a very dry sense of humor and he would tell you, "You know what? You shouldn't even watch tonight's film.
Go to bed."
Yeah. And the funny thing, John, is I remember it made me say, "No, I should watch this.
You want to watch it more.
It made me want to watch it."
Right.
And I know.
Reverse psychology.
Yeah. I don't know if you know this or not, but on the very first program that Bob did at KCRA, he had a copy of TV Guide and he opened it up and he read to the viewers what was on the other channel. Because my movie tonight is so horrible.
That's awesome. That's brilliant. That's hilarious. It really is.
The next morning, the car dealerships from Roseville, who were the sponsors, called up the station and started complaining about Bob Wilkins and what he had done the night before.
That's great.
And they were even suggesting maybe he should be fired. And the manager who's talking to these people said, "Just a moment. I think there's something you need to know. Bob had the highest rating in his time slot last night."
Whoa. Oh, wow. That's great.
Nielsen ratings went out of the room.
That's crazy.
Because of Bob's introduction.
That's
the
great.
Very first horror film.
So Bob had a certain kind of sense of humor. He was very dry. He was very
definitely.
Relaxed.
Yes.
He would always start the show. He'd light a candle, which had a skull on it. Yes. And then he'd start smoking.
He's
the
in
cigar.
A yellow rocking chair.
Yes, yeah. Yellow rocking chair. And I know that
Watch Horror Films is on the wall as it is behind you.
Yes. I love it. But he, you know, people say they love Bob Wilkins so much. But John, I remember that he brought you on the show several times. Then you started to do the Friday show. then Bob was going to leave and they were trying to find a new host. And I don't know if you remember this, but he actually read a list of who they were considering. And one of them was
I didn't know that.
Yes. And one of them was Leon Heskett. And he gave these bizarre names. And one of them was John Stanley. He called you the dark horse of the Chronicle. And I remember going, yelling at the TV. And I remember yelling at the TV, John, saying, "Bob, you idiot! John's the one that should get the job." I remember thinking, "Are you really seriously considering these other people?" I was like livid. And then he made the announcement. He brings you on, and he goes, "Well, John, you know, congratulations." And you go, "Hey, but my first film is going to be The Wolfman. Isn't that great?" And John goes, "Great, The Wolfman. Done from 19 to 1940s. And he says, "Look, folks, I just saw a list of John's movies and I got out just in time."
Oh. Well, John, and that's a distinct difference between you two, was that he had this charm and wit, but he wasn't necessarily a genre fan.
He didn't know anything about movies.
Right.
He's not a movie fan.
Right. You know. It was his personality. Yeah.
And John, that's what I loved about you, because when I watched you, you had all this information about the film. You did these mini movies and you had guests. Bob had guests too, but it seems like you put your all into it, but you weren't Bob Wilkins. You were your own person. And I loved watching you.
I think that was very important. In fact, I was walking down the hallway at Channel 2 one day. I was there watching Bob do a show. I hadn't started. I'd been picked, but I hadn't done the show yet. And he said, "Hey, how do you plan to fill Bob Wilkins' boots?" So I had to do an audition tape. So I took my army boots and I held them up as I was doing this audition. And I said, someone had asked me, "How am I going to fill Bob's boots?" Well, here they are. And I had a pitcher of water and I put water in.
Nice.
That's great.
Yeah. What happened was I did the audition. It was late 1978. It was probably early December. And I had gone on a brief Christmas trip, and I came home on Christmas Eve. At about 7 o'clock, the phone rang, and it was Judith Morgan Jennings, the publicist from Channel 2. And she says, "Well, we had the Christmas party the other night for Channel 2, and I overheard two executives talking to each other, and you have been picked to replace Bob."
Wow.
Can you imagine this on Christmas Eve?
Oh, my gosh.
That's
a great present.
Eve.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until, I think, the day after Christmas, 2 days later, Judith said, "Well, give so-and-so a call." And I called the executives and, come on in on Friday. We're going to teach you how to do the show.
That's amazing. So, that's quite the stocking stuffer right there.
I had never done a television show, but one of my early interviews was about Phantasm.
I remember it.
Angus Grimm, the tall man.
Oh, yes.
We're in the city in midweek. And if someone came in midweek, that means I could get a cameraman to leave the station, come to wherever we're going to meet, and film the interview. Well, I just came up with this idea. Phantasm had a cemetery in it. So I said, "Why don't we meet at a cemetery?"
Nice.
Perfect. Yes.
So the director and Angus Grimm showed up. We had a hearse, and Angus picked me up and threw me into the back of the hearse. And I was the beginning of the interview.
Nice.
And then we drove around in it, and I would ask the questions, and they would answer.
We had to get it
done very quickly because they had a flight out of San Francisco Airport, which was only 10 minutes away.
Right.
But they were they had to leave, so I got all of the answers to my questions first, then they left, and then the hearse drove through the cemetery with me, reverse angle,
asking
all the questions.
That's smart.
That's awesome.
That's great.
And that was the first of what we called mini movies, M-I-N-I movies.
The mini movies.
Films that were made outside the studio.
Yes. Yeah.
And for listeners who aren't familiar, it was so great. John did more than just being a host. When he would do these mini movies, it's like he would go out of the studio.
for example,
it's a full movie, Chuck Norris, with a narrative, and
Chuck Norris had his very first movie.
Yep.
Good guys wear black.
Mm-hmm.
So I decided to meet him at a karate studio on Madison Avenue in San Francisco.
He was tough. He was tough.
And his brother were there. He had his brother too. So I very quickly designed a way where he's got all these unconscious bodies around him on the, out on the really carpet. Funny. And I've got my microphone and I'm slowly sneaking up to ask him the first question.
That's awesome.
And he whirls around and he finally puts me down on the carpet at the end of the interview.
Yes, he does.
Yes, John.
I remember watching that and freaking out because for listeners, John's holding the microphone and does it. Chuck like kind of grabs your neck and he goes, doesn't he kind of throw you?
Chuck came back a couple of years later to make a movie over near Orinda called An Eye for an Eye.
Oh, yeah.
I was able to go on location. We did a two-parter.
Nice.
And Richard Roundtree, who had played Shaft in the movie.
Yeah, sure, of course.
He was playing a policeman. And so we did this sequence where I'm coming down the hill toward the movie set and he draws his gun and says, "Hold it. What are you doing here? You're not supposed to be, you're not supposed to be on this location, you know?" Mm-hmm. And that was the first of a two-part interview.
I remember that you said, you actually say Shaft. And then he goes, No. Richard Roundtree. Really funny.
There was a restaurant called Casablanca, and I knew a publicist man who loved to do an impression of Humphrey Bogart. Mm-hmm. Whatever you may have thought of it, he was doing his best to be a Bogart-like character. So we did Return to Casablanca,
nice.
Where we filmed it. There was this beautiful half-naked dancing lady.
I remember well.
And then we had, you know, we did satire on the movie Casablanca, some of the lines and so on.
Yes.
Yeah.
And also we went to the Wax Museum. We did a two-part episode from there.
From the Fisherman's Wharf.
Fisherman's Wharf, right. Yeah.
For the DVD, we did some new footage in the Wax Museum at Fisherman's Wharf. But no, it was fun. I got to play Sherlock Holmes in one of the episodes.
Yeah.
I missed the haunted mine, that ride that was.
Yeah, that was another popular one.
Because I used to go, that used to be my birthday parties. You know, every other kid would go, you know, they'd go to some park or something and I'd take all my friends to the Wax Museum.
Yeah, so we could look at monsters. Mine of lost souls.
Yeah. I miss all that stuff.
Oh, that's a shame. Yeah. Now, John, in some of these mini movies, I remember sometimes you would also go to a place within the San Francisco Bay Area that to kind of showcase like detective books or a special bookstore.
Oh yeah. The mystery bookstore.
Yeah. And didn't you have your son in one of those two?
Little guy. Wearing a trench coat.
Yeah.
And a hat. He looked like a miniature private detective.
And I remember seeing him going, "Damn it. I want to do that."
I know.
You know, my son is an amazing character. He went on to become vice president of ticket sales for a baseball team you might have heard of called the San Francisco Giants.
No. But John, is he a monster fan? Is he
still doing detective work?
Well, he's seeking, how do I fill those empty seats?
Yeah, really, exactly.
Although they're starting to fill up again.
Right.
He's been on the phone a lot. He's done a lot of, you know, Zoom contacts over the last 2 years.
John, I wanted to ask you though, before you met Bob and before he even started writing, what hooked you into horror films and sci-fi and fantasy cinema
and
at
comics
at an early age? You know, like what got you into that?
My father was a movie lover. During World War II, he was putting floors in some of the barracks we lived in Oakland. Mm-hmm. And we would take a cable car on the Bay Bridge, which is gone now. It's not there.
Right.
And we would go to Fifth and Market to a theater that played newsreels, 24 hours newsreels.
Really?
Wow. And next to it was a double feature theater. So we'd see some newsreels and we'd go next door and we'd see Western movies or mystery movies or so on. Horror and science fiction movies really didn't come into vogue until the late 40s, early 50s.
Right.
And seeing The Thing from Another World, the 1951 film.
Yeah.
James Arness portrays an extraterrestrial life form unit, you know. Yeah. And also The Day the Earth Stood Still.
Oh, sure.
Patricia Neal is taken into the flying saucer. Mm-hmm. She's all alone, trapped in there. And here comes Gort, the robot monster.
Yes.
And I'll never forget the look on her face.
Yes.
And those two films, I saw those around the time I was 11 years old. And from then on, I had a curiosity about all of these monster movies. These
that's horror awesome.
What, sounds like a familiar story. 50s,
yeah, yeah.
When they came on television, all of the old Universal
right. movies. Yeah, right. That's how we
finally
all,
see yeah. these now.
Yeah.
Things I had not seen because I wasn't around at the time.
Right.
When they aired on television, John, were there any horror hosts introducing them that you sort of personally grew up with that had any kind of influence on
no,
you?
No, the first horror host was around 1954. Was it Vampyra?
Vampyra, yeah. Vampyra,
the woman who was in Plan 9 from Outer Space. She's really the very, very first. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until 1957 when Universal did release all of their horror films.
The Shock Theater
Dracula
package.
And Wolfman and all the rest. That's when the horror host thing really began across the country.
Right.
1957, you saw the coming of Goulardi.
Zachary.
Sure.
We had eventually Elvira to imitate Elvira.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mistress of the Dark.
Now, John, we
became a good friend.
Matt and I, so we grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area, so we had creature features, but Sean and James grew up in different places. They had their own.
Yeah. Like
every city seemed to have its own characterization.
Yeah, I was
a different kind of monster costume.
Right. Everybody had their own.
There was a rich variety. Yeah.
I grew up with Chili Billy for Chiller Theater. I also had Uncle Ted's Ghoul School. There's a guy called The Creep. Those are mine because I was like Pennsylvania East Coast. So those are the channels I got. But
I grew up. My earliest horror movie memories are from a show called Classic Horror in New England, and there was no horror host. They just showed this little montage of images from the old Universal monster movies, like a close up of Lugosi and Karloff is the mummy just coming to life. And it wasn't until a few years later I moved to New York, but I still didn't get a horror host because Zachary was before my time. So I missed out on horror hosts in real time and I had to catch up on them. I guess the only horror host I was actually exposed to in, say, prime time was Count Floyd from SCTV.
Which I love.
Around now, the time there were scores. There was a book that came out a few years ago that more or less had a few pages about each one.
Yeah, there's a couple books I have, actually, horror hosts.
I can't remember the title.
Around the time of Creature Features, because I saw the very first episode of Creature Features. And before that, there was a guy that was on Channel 20, the UHF channel, Asmodeus, who had something. Yeah. But that's like almost like a fever dream memory. But then it was Bob Wilkins. He wore a costume. And so seeing Bob Wilkins come on and be in his regular clothing was so interesting to me. And it's interesting that the fact that he's not dressed like a monster was unique for a horror show. And then around that time, Channel 20, they would play The Ghoul. Was like the son of Goulardi, one Swede, and then so it would be like dueling hosts, but Creature Features always won. And then you come along.
Well, Creature Features, don't forget, was in prime time at 9 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
When Bob came to Channel 2, the executives decided, why put him on at 11 o'clock? Let's try 9 o'clock at night and let's see what happens. And it worked.
It helped me stay awake through some of those movies.
No, definitely.
You know,
9 o'clock. You know what? That was opposite NBC Saturday Night at the Movies. 9 o'clock. Right. That was those were Alfred Hitchcock movies and, you know, major first features.
Hefty competition. Yeah.
That's what he was up against. Yeah. And he did very well.
Did you often beat them in the ratings? Like, were there times where you?
I think there were times when Bob had very high ratings. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
definitely.
You know, John, there are two special episodes of Creature Features. One that I'll always remember. One is with Bob Wilkins when he was going to show Godzilla versus the Thing and then Godzilla versus the Smog Monster. And I had seen the Smog Monster before. And John, my life changed when I saw the Smog Monster, because for the first time as a kid, I saw at the beginning of the movie, you see a little kid playing with a Godzilla toy. And I flipped out, John, my mind exploded. And I said, you know what? It might not be next week. It might not be next month or next year, but one day I will have those toys. And it took me 20 years to eventually get to Japan and get those toys, which are now in my collection.
Yeah. Yeah.
The other time happened to be when you were hosting, and I always get excited when my birthday fell on a Saturday and Creature Feature movie is going to be on. I'm like, please, please, for my birthday, have it be a good movie. Have it be a good movie. And sure enough, on October 11th, on this Saturday, this is, I believe, 1980, you guys showed When Worlds Collide, which I had never seen. Wow. And I just loved it. I went, and I remember looking at the screen and going, John, thank you. Thank you for putting on such a great movie for my birthday. So,
well, that's
just
wonderful. You know, what you're saying,
yeah,
something we haven't discussed yet. And that is in 1999, Bob Wilkins and I were invited to appear at a show in Sacramento at a nightclub. And it was the beginning of a cycle. The very next year, 2000, Tom Wersch, who lived in Marin County, he was a fan, and he came to Bob and he came to me, and he began to suggest, let's get back before the public. In fact, Tom did scrapbooks on each of us.
Yes.
Which sold out very well.
Yes, I have.
Me too.
Then there was a theater in Oakland, the Parkway. Mm-hmm. Where Bob and I appeared. Bob Shaw, who had been the helper of Bob Wilkins at Channel 2.
Right.
And then he became the movie critic for the station for many years. He was there also. It was the beginning of a cycle that would go on for almost a decade until Bob's death in 2009, where we met the kind of fan that you were, Larry. You used to come up to us and tell us what it was like on Saturday night when you used to watch the show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You watched it with your brother, your sister, mom and dad, or whatever the combination, girlfriend, boyfriend.
Go ahead.
And it was a memory that you are never going to forget.
Yes. Yes.
And we heard this story told over and over again, and each individual had his own way of expressing it.
Yeah.
But the fellow who helped start was a Will the Thrill Viero.
Oh.
There's an actor named Viero. I think is it Robert Viero?
Maybe.
Anyway, his son was Will the Thrill. He called himself the Thrill. And he and his wonderful wife would put on shows at the Parkway Theater every week. Theme shows, you know, different kinds of themes.
Sure.
And he ended up doing a show with us every year at the Parkway Theater.
Oh, wow.
6 years.
I know August Ragone, who was one of our, he was on the show.
Yeah, he's a Japanese movie expert.
Yeah, we had him on the show, and he's lovely. And I know that Bob helped him out with a convention that he did that was, I think, anime.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I went to that convention.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Yeah. And so, you know,
Augie and I appeared together. We each had a new book. Mm-hmm. I think it was back in 2007 when I did. Yeah. I was a horror host. Well, he had a book about Japanese.
The Tsuburaya book.
Tsuburaya.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Right. Exactly. Beautiful. Right.
Yeah.
And we had a couple of bookstores together.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Augie was also involved in putting on shows at the Castro Theater.
That's right.
Right.
Bob Johnson. Bob Johnson had a Bay Area company that put on shows at various locations.
Yeah, Augie helped put some Godzilla shows on at the Castro.
Yeah. Really, I think there was one just recently.
But to know that you have launched this whole generation of monster kids. I mean, it really is like watching Creature Features from Bob Wilkins and then you taking it over to keep this legacy alive. It was my sacred time. It would be my time where it really felt important. And when I go back and I see old tapes of that show, I mean, it just brings such a joy to my heart.
Well, you know, one of the things that was fortunate for me at the Chronicle, I was meeting just so many. I think I told you I interviewed approximately 800 famous souls, movies and television and nightclubs and whatever. With my contacts at the Chronicle, I was able to stay in touch with all of the media outlets in the Bay Area. So when I got to Channel 2, I contacted the Walt Disney publicist who did the Bay Area.
Yeah.
And I said, I tape my shows on Friday mornings. And would it be possible for you, if you have a new film you're opening, to bring your guests on, have them come into the Bay Area, say on Thursday night, then Friday you can drive them over to Channel 2. We'll tape the show. It will air the next night, and we will highlight the new Walt Disney film opening next Friday.
Right.
Yeah.
So everybody who is watching would now be aware of, hey, Walt Disney has a new feature film.
Yes.
That included Ray Bradbury.
Right.
He had, what was the film?
Something Wicked This Way Comes. Yep.
And I want to share a story there. He was at the Fairmont Hotel, and I went up and we did a very long filmed interview. This is 1981. And then I said, gee, Ray, I'd like to do a story about you for the Chronicle. Can we get together and have dinner or something? So, okay, we went to a restaurant across the street from the Fairmont, and Ray's wife was there. Mm-hmm. And apparently she was angry at Walt Disney about the studio, about something. I'm not sure, but it was there just from her behavior. She took the menu and put it in front of Ray and said, Ray, I want you to order this. And he looks at the menu and he says, honey, that's a $100 bottle of champagne. Yes, order it. So Ray did. So during dinner, we had $100 bottle of champagne.
Wow.
Okay, it's time for dessert, okay?
What's the most expensive cheesecake you have?
What's the most expensive steak Ray, you have?
Wow, that's great.
Ray, put it in front of him, Ray. I want another bottle of this.
No.
So we had a second bottle.
Oh, wow.
We had two bottles of champagne, each one $100.
Nice. Wow. Right.
Nothing like a good woman, you know?
Yeah, a great wife.
But Ray Bradbury was one of those amazing individuals. I was able to see him speak several times, and he was so fascinating. He was so inspirational, too. I mean, you got to have him one-on-one. What was that like? I mean, that must have been so fun.
Oh, Ray was just fantastic. Just like the story I have in my book coming out, he really gets into the depth of how he writes a story, what motivates him, what's good, what's bad. Mm-hmm. He just covered all the bases and just goes on for several pages. Mm-hmm. And I find myself just kind of just carried away into what his brain was like. The same with Robert Bloch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, you're able to sit there for a couple hours asking all these questions, and sometimes it leads into an unexpected area. Yes.
Yeah. Cool.
Well, anyway, after the Walt Disney star of the new movie had done the interview, my wife and I would then go to a restaurant in San Francisco that same evening, and I would do the Chronicle interview. Nice. So I would be able to approach this individual from two totally different directions.
Right.
Yeah. One, you want to try to get as much perhaps stills, photographs, scenes from movies, some excerpts from movies. So it's a two totally different kind of approaches to gathering your material that's got to hold your reader or your viewer in some kind of tension and suspense, you hope.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, and that was the thing about the transition from Bob to you, which obviously you are not Bob. You can't be Bob. Bob was his own thing. But what was great about the transition was that it was tonally correct. The way that you made that transition by making the show your own, but it was, it still felt like Creature Features. And that's quite a task. I really admired what you did and the direction you took it, and, you know, with the movies and the sense of fun. And
The satire that would be with the mini movie.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, yeah.
You're making fun. You're spoofing Humphrey Bogart.
The stuff you love.
Spoofing the kind of music, maybe that music was very important. I always and I was able to use a lot of soundtrack elements. From Star Wars, and but also from mystery movies and all kinds of music.
Yeah, you know?
I would play that game where I try to identify the music.
Yes.
And,
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fun.
It's funny, John, because during when you would transition from like back from a commercial break, you sometimes you would have music playing and you would hear your voice saying, don't forget next week is blah, 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 or you show pictures and you would play music. And I remember, I think you played some stuff from Neil Norman
Neil Norman was a guest a couple of times.
Yes, he was a couple of guests. And the funny thing is I would always try to identify that music. And John, when I listen to you, when I watch, I love Bob Wilkins, but John, I think I identified more with you because it just seemed like you had a genuine love for the stuff that you talked about. And when you talked about someone, like when you say, and Kerwin Matthews is in this, Kerwin Matthews did this film, and you give me information about that actor or the director. And I love
You are a source of information in history as well as being a fun host.
I usually tried to have some background, you know, if I can get up and find it.
Also, I think we talked about how you inspired generations. That was the thing about, regardless of whatever horror host any of us grew up with, wherever we were, especially back in our time when there's not a ton of cable channels or DVDs.
Yeah, there was no VCR yet.
So that was like a personal friend in your home you went to at night that introduced you to all this whole world. And that, because especially when we were too young yet to go to a movie theater by ourselves.
Right.
So
yeah.
It was you guys that kind of like ushered all this stuff into our lives. I mean, you guys were like, you literally hosted our lives as far as the films. You know?
Yeah. And also when it comes to the movies that you would show too, what I loved is like, as Sean was saying, you were like that friend sitting next to us, giving us information and also saying, well, this is not that great or it is great. But the movies that you would play though were also maybe a little more violent than you would find
More
obscure.
That's what I love.
And as a horror fan,
movies did become more violent. In fact, that's one of the reasons the manager of the station finally decided in 1984 to cancel the show.
It was changing times.
I don't know if you guys remember, but for John, this is very important. Famous Monsters stopped publishing just before 1983.
The magazine?
The magazine. Yeah. And then Creature Features went off the air on 84. And I'm flipping out. And I couldn't figure out what. I'm still watching. So, John, what was it? Was it people
like slashers? Or?
Is it because of the VCR? Or you're saying it was some
cable at that point, too?
No, there were movies that were really becoming gory and violent in that period.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Not in a good way.
So it was the station manager said, we're done with this.
That's what I was told.
But Fox came in.
Nobody ever told me any other reason why the show was being canceled. And I think I made a mistake, if I could share it with you.
Please.
I kind of accepted it.
Really?
Although I did go to another station to see if maybe they would like to carry on the franchise, but they didn't. So I should have said, well, instead of a series weekly, why don't we do a show once a month? Mm-hmm. I'll bring in some really special good names from Hollywood or wherever we can go, local writers, science fiction, fantasy writers.
Right.
But let's see if we can, maybe we could do a half hour show where all we do is we try to cover what new movies are coming out or what new books are available.
Mm-hmm. That would have been fantastic.
And I never actually sat down with management and did that. And I I kind of thought about it later, you know, and it was too late. Right.
Well, when Creature Feature ended, it was like, it was almost like a part of me died, you know, and I had to, but then what happened is then you had, you know, with the VHS cassette. And so now I'm thinking, well, I can go and rent this movie and I can watch it without commercial breaks. But John, I always missed seeing my horror hosts.
Yeah.
It's not the same.
Having that guest.
Yeah.
You know, whoever it might've been. A Ray Bradbury, a Robert Bloch. We haven't talked about much about Robert Bloch.
Oh, please. When
he was a guest on the show, there was a joke he had written years before, which was someone asked him, they tell me you have the heart of a small child. Is that true? And then he apparently opens up a desk drawer or whatever, and there's the heart of a small child. My wife went out and bought some animal body remains. And we put them in a bottle, and we covered it with a black blanket. So I'm asking him this question: is it true, Mr. Bloch, that you have the heart of a small child? And so he lifts it off, and there's the heart. You know,
that's awesome.
Terrific.
You know, you've mentioned your wife a few times. She's great, because I remember meeting you for the first time at a convention and she was there.
Oh, so was she? Oh.
Yes. Was she always supportive with you during this?
She was really, Erica was really wonderful. One of the great things, history about her, just briefly, she grew up in Germany. She was born in Nazi Germany and grew up there.
Wow. Really?
Oh, wow. In 1950, her mother married a GI, a bridge reconstructor.
Uh-huh.
And he was going to bring them to America. And she became, her mother was the last war bride. Remember the war bride program?
Yes.
Yeah.
Her mother, Racy, was the very last, and they stopped the program after that.
Really?
Wow. And Erica's father had died on the Russian front. He was in the army and he drove ambulances and stuff for the doctors and nurses.
Wow.
He was killed on the Russian front.
Jeez.
But no, she was just wonderful. Any problem that would come up, she was taking care of it.
Mm-hmm.
I've told you about a couple with Chris Lee and Leonard Nimoy and I don't know, those were the major moments, I guess.
Well, thinking back on that. Well, John, the you know, Creature Features has meant so much to us. And John, Matt and I, we'd watch every week religiously. But I think maybe Matt didn't watch every show because I have a question that I want to ask you, John.
Was he sober on Saturday night?
It's funny you should bring that up because that's when I started to go through my hooligan phase. Yeah.
Yes. See, why Matt was going to hooligan school, I was still watching. And John, I want to see if you remember this, because Matt says he doesn't remember this.
Okay.
So it's a very infamous episode. You start the show by saying, hey, and stay with us till the end of the show. I have something special to show you. As you're talking, behind you, you have like this little jail or a little cave, and there are these two women dressed up as witches, and they got creepy makeup on. You have these tattered shirts, and they're trying to eat like a bone. They're fighting over it. And so I watched the movie. I get to the end of the show. It's about maybe like 12:30 or 1 a.m. And you say, look at the audience and go, well, the censors decided to go home early tonight. And we've got this little clip to show you of what happened to our witches just before we started. And then you show this clip. It's about a minute long. And it shows the witches behind. They're grabbing the bone. And all of a sudden, their breasts pop out of their shirts. Whoa. And do you remember this?
Well, I remember... I remember there were a couple of girls who got into a fight.
Yes.
It was actually at the beginning of the show. I was opening the show with them. Mm-hmm. And as they were struggling, the breasts of one of the women became exposed.
That.
Now, Matt? What happened was we went and shot it a second time.
Yeah.
But I was told later that the scene was the first scene was saved and passed around to various executives and employees at Channel 2.
Nice.
And you aired it. You aired it, John. I
really?
Saw it.
It really aired?
I wonder if that's another, that would have been another thing. I don't particularly have a memory of it, but it happened.
John, once again, we'd like to thank you for
enlightening us,
taking us to a place that we needed to go.
Now, John, are you serious? Do you really not remember? I mean, you, nudge, nudge, wink, wink. I mean, I remember you distinctly saying the censor was either he was on vacation or he took the night off or he left early, and you showed a little clip. And I remember going,
well, the struggle with the two women.
Things happen.
Yeah, things happen.
Well, I just don't know.
Things happen between two.
I thought that the scene was not shown.
Well,
what I remember was the opening scene of the show.
Yeah. But to be fair, TVU would play movies with nudity from time to time.
That's true. Once in a while, it was late night, local television. Yeah.
I think it was a British Hammer film, maybe.
Yes.
Where they showed some nudity. Yeah.
And Walkabout.
Kind of controversial.
Walkabout with Jenny Agutter also. I have a list of all the ones. I have a scrapbook.
And then, there was Night of the Living Dead that they showed, and there's the whole backside of the zombie woman cadaver. Walking by. Yeah. I mean, again, I saw this on Creature Features late at night.
Uh-huh. Right, right.
When I was talking about the violent films, like I think of that one, and what I loved is the fact that you would take something that would not necessarily be your standard universal horror film, but something maybe a little bit more edgy and show us that as well. Because I mean, what do we know about Night of the Living Dead? I mean, I think that was the first time it ever played on television was on KTVU.
And
it's still, to me, it still is wonderful today.
I'm not sure about that. I do have a memory that I borrowed the print of Night of the Living Dead and I brought it home, and my son Russ went out and told all of his friends at school to the house tonight we're going to show Night of the Living Dead.
Wow.
And I believe it was before I became the host. I think it was Bob had told me at some point, if you ever want to borrow a movie,
you could do that,
you know. And I think it was before I became the host. At least that's my
memory. Well, yes, yeah. But I know that it played.
And my house was full of children.
I was going to say, Russ was pretty popular, wasn't he? We're going to watch Night of the Living Dead.
right.
Do you remember the name of the actress?
Who was the new?
Judith O'Day.
You're Judith O'Day?
There are pictures of her and me together in my new book.
Oh, nice. Oh. Nice. She's great. And, we've been heard
so nice.
We are on the pitcher's mound at the San Francisco Giants baseball field.
Nice.
And Bob Johnson put on a show there where I interviewed Judy first, then it got dark, and then we played the film.
Nice.
Night of the Living Dead.
That's cool.
At Giants Stadium?
Yeah.
Oh, I think that was so great.
Around 2010, 2011, somewhere in there, I think.
And that was another thing that you did that really stands out to me, is that you would provide these free tickets to films.
Oh, yeah.
When the show was on. And I saw so many of them.
I think Phantasm was one of those. Send in for a ticket and we would either rent a theater, we show it in a movie theater, or a couple of times we went to where the newspaper and critics gather to see a film, a new film. There's a small screening room on Market Street, a second in Market.
I saw At the Earth's Core with my mom.
Happy. Nice.
And it was terrific. Yeah.
Uh-huh. That's great.
See, that's great, Matt. Because, you know, I wasn't as lucky as you. I would send things. I didn't win anything.
Wait a minute. All you needed was a self-addressed
stamp.
What a
sad creature.
Exactly. We say that all the time, but all you needed was a self-addressed stamped envelope and you would get the ticket.
I would put the thing up at the end of a segment. Yeah.
Well, maybe it's because I lived in San Jose. I wasn't like San Francisco.
Always an excuse.
I don't know. But it's okay, John. It's okay. I do not hold that against you. I didn't think that you're actually opening the envelopes yourself and going, who's this kid in San Jose? Let's toss this. I don't know. I don't think that at all. When I looked at you on TV, you were a friend. Okay.
Yes,
you,
always.
Right.
Okay, very good. Yeah.
We brought up Night of the Living Dead. That was probably the scariest thing I had ever seen on television.
Yes.
And the funny thing is, I actually, when I watched that on Creature Features, that commercial break was, oh my God, that was my saving grace, because I was so terrified.
You had to decompress.
Yeah. Yes, Sean. Yes. I mean, the first time I saw it on Creature, and John, I actually had to wake my brother and sister up to come and watch this. And within 5 minutes, they went back to bed. They were freaking out. And I'm watching it down the living room by myself. Maybe a commercial's coming any second, you know.
Yeah. I was terrified by the trailer.
Yeah, trailer.
Yes. The trailer with the spooky voice.
Night of the Living Dead.
You know, and that's another thing that was great about Creature Features, John, when you guys would show the trailers. You would show trailers of these.
Yeah. Oh, I had an entire show one time devoted to trailers, you know, going back to the 30s, 40s.
And people forget.
Trailers have changed so much.
Oh, I know.
When you see a trailer from the 40s or 50s, it's totally different from the modern.
Completely.
Sure.
Totally different.
It makes you want to see the movie.
Yeah, it doesn't give stuff away either.
Sometimes it does, and sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
Now, John, you've published these Creature Features movie guides, which are wonderful.
Yeah, we did 6 of them.
It's amazing.
Wow. Yeah, and I look back on that, and I sometimes say, how in the hell? I used to see 6 or 7 movies a week.
Yeah,
I would see a brand new film that's opening. Mm-hmm. And then I check the TV guide schedules. Oh, there's one I haven't seen.
Mm-hmm.
And, just, you know, gradually week after week, month after month, mm-hmm. Pretty soon you've seen 200 or 300 films.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
And each movie guide got bigger and bigger. And I thought that the 4th edition had the most reviews in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it was most successful in terms of covering all of the genres that I had promised I would cover.
Mm-hmm.
And then books 5 and 6 were done by a New York publisher who didn't want to bring out, because I kept adding more and more, and he didn't want to do that. So we took out the lesser important movies. And
the last two guys
were quite as good as the rest.
John,
you know what?
What?
I did 15,000 of the 4th edition.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
We had 1,000 hardcovers, which were in a box.
Yes.
Sold all of those.
Yep.
And just a year or so ago, well, I have 2 or 3 or 4 copies left at home, but the 15,000 are gone.
Wow. Yeah. I have that hardback book. And John,
you're very lucky. Yeah.
I have a bone to pick with you, John. Just really quickly. Okay. We do an episode every once in a while called the Mad Movie Smackdown. That's right. And John, what we do is we bring a guest on and we all have various movie guide books. And we flip through the book and without even looking, pick one. We just point to it and then we read it and say, oh, have you seen this film? And we just give the review. And of course, I would always go to my trusty Creature Features movie guide because I have all of yours. Okay. And so,
what an intellectual genius.
Yes. But John, I swear to God, I would open it up and every film I find, and it's like, oh, Godzilla versus the Thing. And your review, you it seemed like you hated it. You go, oh, another silly, stupid film or something. I'm like, oh, does he not like Godzilla films? There's some films in there that I go, does he even like horror movies? It made me so mad. Now, are you like, when you see all these films, do you feel that you try to make it a little more jokey? Or do you really feel that, I really didn't like this Godzilla versus the Thing? Or what's the scoop here?
Well, that's a difficult question. You know, every movie is different, and you're sitting there in a certain time of your life. with a certain schedule around you for that particular period.
Sure. Uh-huh.
And unfortunately, you know what's happened to me?
What's happened?
I've recently seen some films and I couldn't remember. And I wondered, are they in my book? Did I see this? And I go to my book and I would find it there. In other words, it's as if that's another person who wrote that, you know, 20 years ago or whatever.
Oh,
today, when I look at it, it's a totally different kind of situation.
Do you have a number of situations like that where you will watch a movie years later and think, maybe I was a little hard on that one?
Yeah, I might have been, yeah.
You know, we did an episode.
I don't remember. You know what?
What?
I hardly remember any what I wrote in this book. I would have to go. If you asked me, what did you think of a certain movie? I'd really have to go to the book to find out.
Hey, guys.
I just don't remember. There just what about wasn't this? Enough room up here.
What if we play a quick round of the Mad Movie Smackdown with the book?
Revenge.
Is that a contest or?
It's a game that's not really a game because we're all winners when it comes to Creature Features Movie Guide. But what we do is we just flip through some pages and then you would say stop and I would put my finger on an entry and we'd read it. And let's just see what you wrote. Does that sound okay?
Yeah,
do it.
Sure.
All right, let's do it.
All right, Matt, go.
I'm going to start flipping and John, just say stop.
Stop.
Okay. And I'm going to point. Here we go. Ooh, this is Murderer's Row.
Murderer's Row.
Second in the simple-minded Matt Helm series with Dean Martin as the super spy who walks indifferently through his bizarre adventures. Brimming with succulent women, correct. Yes. Gleaming gadgets, ingenious weapons, and flippant dialogue. And never for a moment taking itself seriously. You'll enjoy Carl Malden as a villain with a killer Ray who hopes to destroy the White House. The stylish way it's directed by Henry Levin, you might just as well set your brain on idle and enjoy. Anne Margaret, Carmilla Sparv, Beverly Adams, Tony Reese. That is
that's what I remember accurate. About his films. They were fun to watch.
Yeah, I think that's spot on. Really
women,
I think,
you know.
That's a great review. Yeah, I think that's
kind of tongue in cheek.
Yeah.
Yeah.
1966, yeah. Murderer's Row.
You know, I will say this, Matt. Roger Ebert was famous for he ripped into Night of the Living Dead. He hated it. But years later, about 20 years later, his attitude towards it, he changed. He actually
he changed his opinions about a lot of movies, actually.
Well, yeah, that is true.
Sometimes the world has a generic attitude about it.
Yeah.
And he has to look at now, why am I not part of that? You know, why didn't I feel that?
Yep.
As you were saying, it's like every brain I was a different guy.
You know, every brain is different in the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are no two alike.
Okay. Nope. John, I'm curious with all the films that you've reviewed, is there one that actually stands out? Is there one favorite horror film of yours?
The Thing will always be memorable to me because I saw it in the summer of 1951 and I was afraid to walk down the hallway to go to my bedroom. It was dark and it was, is there anything, you know, that's got to leap out at me?
That's the one.
Definitely. That's gosh, one. You know, I've never really, there are some other films, they're not necessarily horror films. The Steel Helmet, a Samuel Fuller movie from 1951, will always stand out in my mind. And this has nothing to do with movie horror. This is with real life horror. Like, I'm going to tell you a story. My father in 1945 landed in Manila on the island of Luzon.
Mm-hmm.
The slaughter of Manila had just taken place.
Oh, wow.
The Japanese, knowing they were going to lose the war, they were losing all the battles in the Philippine Islands, got drunk, got high on drugs, and went out and started killing women and children. Jeez. And anybody they could get their hands on in the city of Manila. Wow. So it was a slaughter. Well, my father landed there. He remembered it was after the had taken place. And he went on a patrol into the jungle with standing next to him was his best friend. And a machine gun opened fire. And his best friend went down with a bullet in his forehead.
Yeah. Jeez.
And the first bullet that hit my father was in right here. And years later, he would call it the Kirk Douglas dimple.
Wow. Jeez.
Jokingly, because he liked Kirk Douglas.
Sure. Wow.
The second bullet, nothing to worry about. It hit him in the shoulder over here. Nothing, forget it. But the third bullet missed his heart, and he'd go like this, about a half inch.
Whoa.
The doctors were afraid to remove it because of where it was positioned. And he lived the rest of his life carrying that bullet.
Wow.
On the island of Luzon, yeah.
Jeez.
He lived into his mid-60s and died of a stroke.
Wow.
When he was about 66.
So the film, The Steel Helmet, though, has...
Oh, The Steel Helmet.
A powerful movie.
Dad loved war movies, you know. Yeah. It was, my mom never understood this. And after what he went through.
Right.
On Sunday night, we saw Sands of Iwo Jima at the Uptown Theater in Napa. On Monday night at the Fox Theater, we saw 12 O'Clock High, two war movie classics.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Never forgotten that. But The Steel Helmet by Sam Fuller, I don't know if you're familiar with
Sam Fuller. Oh, yes. Sure.
He made made war movies.
Crime films,
Shock Corridor.
Shock Corridor. Oh, I had dinner with him one night, Eric and I.
Wow.
He took us out to dinner, and he said, don't plan anything after dinner. I got a surprise for you. And so we went to a screening room where we saw Shock Corridor.
Wow.
Before it was released to theaters.
Nice.
Wow.
Well, the cinematographer for the film, Stanley Cortez, he came to the screening. Sam had invited him because he hadn't seen the film. This was the first cut.
Wow.
And so we all sat and saw the film for the first time.
Wow. That's cool.
And
that's amazing.
I'll never forget Sam taking us to see Shock Corridor. A few months later, he was making The Naked Kiss.
Another favorite.
Wow. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Yes, on Samuel Goldwyn's studio. And I spent 2 days on the set. Eric and I were invited, and we watched the shooting.
Really?
Some pictures were taken of us together.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know who I can't remember who the producer was, but he came up to talk to Sam, and I'm standing nearby. And he says, Sam, we have to change the name of the movie. Well, it wasn't The Naked Kiss. It was The Iron Kiss.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that was the original title.
Oh.
The Iron Kiss was that of a sexual pervert.
Oh.
Because one of the characters in the film gets related to... Well,
interesting. Well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So the producer says, well, Iron Kiss... makes it sound almost like a war movie or something, but Naked Kiss gives it a more sexual approach.
More salacious.
Sure. Yeah.
Yes.
And so he and Sam got into a battle over this. And I was told this months later by someone who was sort of in the inner circle that because Sam didn't want to change the title, the producer went out and started telling all of his friends and associates that Sam Fuller was this impossible guy to work with. Don't go near him. And Sam didn't get any more low budget. They were all low budget movies he was making, but he was unable to continue in that capacity.
It kind of soiled his reputation.
He moved to Europe. He gave up his home in Hollywood and moved to Europe, divorced his wife. Well, that's all another story.
Yeah. He was a genius, though. I love his movies.
Yeah.
And The Steel Helmet has a scene where Sergeant Zack, played by Gene Evans, loses control and kills a prisoner of war, unarmed prisoner of war. In other words, this is something you don't do.
Right.
You know? And to do it in a movie, somehow the movie slipped through the cracks of the censorship board.
Right.
There's all kinds of stuff in that movie that there's all kinds of racial talk and themes in that movie.
He always explored that stuff.
Chinese soldier and a black man. Yeah.
All the way till later in the 80s, he did White Dog.
Right. Well, yeah.
It was a disaster at the box office.
Yeah, I know. But it's a fascinating movie, though.
It's a good movie.
Yeah.
It was.
I love so many of his films.
Yeah.
In fact, I called Sam, or I found out Sam was in Hollywood. He had come from Europe and he was making that movie. And I said, Sam, I've written a script. If you could come and do my creature feature show with me, we're going to meet up where the flag is on the cemetery in San Bruno.
Mm-hmm.
Where the cemetery is there. Mm-hmm. And I said, we're going to meet up there and I'm going to talk about your career in the military.
Oh, wow.
He was on Omaha Beach on D-Day.
Wow.
He fought across Europe to Czechoslovakia. And there was a concentration camp there. In fact, there was footage of it he had taken with his 16-millimeter camera that he carried in his backpack. Birkenau, I believe, was the name of the concentration camp. Mm-hmm. And it was the last days of the war, April of 45. And the officer said, Sam, do you still have your camera? Please take photographs of all the horrible stuff that's here in Birkenau. Jeez. And so that was actually on YouTube for a while.
Wow. Really?
Wow.
Some years ago. But Sam Fuller took that footage.
Yeah,
he was a remarkable guy.
Yeah. He always, his films pulled no punches. You know, he always went there. He went into the greedy kind of like uncomfortable
what
stuff.
Really like.
And any genre that he tackled, you know, really had his stamp. I mean, I love the Western 40 Guns, I think.
40 Guns. Incredible. Yeah.
With Barbara Stanwyck.
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
John, after Creature Features, I know there was life after Creature Features. I know later on you started to teach some classes at the Elder Hostel. Can you tell us about that?
Oh, yes. David Kleinberg was my editor at the San Francisco Chronicle for 13 years. Mm-hmm. He took over editorship in 1980. And it was a great relationship because I would tell him, hey, if I can go to LA for a couple of days, I can get three stories on Thursday, mm-hmm. story A, B, and C. Then I can get on Friday, I can do D, E, F. And oh, by the way, Leonard Nimoy is in a new Star Trek movie, and I'll be able to land an interview with him or somebody from the we'll have some kind of new Star Trek story.
Right.
And how could he say no?
Yes.
And there was a guy from KPIX, CBS. He was the publicist, and he and I would go to Hollywood together. And we'd do three CBS TV shows. Mm-hmm. At each one, he'd ask everybody, hey, where's a good restaurant to eat? Mm-hmm. And that night, we would go to whatever the best restaurant was that he was able to discover. And one night, we walked into a Beverly Hills restaurant, and there was Alfred Hitchcock.
Oh, my gosh.
On Thursday night, he always sat at the same table.
Oh, my gosh.
And there he was, you know.
Jeez.
Crazy.
Yeah. And so I would come back with just tons of stories. Anyway, I left the Chronicle because I wanted to do more movie guides and so on. And David left, and he started what was then called Elder Hostel. Mm-hmm. Today it's called Rhodes Scholar, a parody of a Rhodes Scholar.
Sure.
Gotcha.
Rhodes Scholar completely changed. And I told David I would. He called me and said, "Would you like to be a teacher?" And I said, "Yeah, I'd love to do classes on the world of entertainment."
That's awesome.
Beautiful women of the movies, famous composers.
Did the Frank Sinatra saga.
Oh, I did a Frank Sinatra class. Yes. Yeah.
On the Road Again with Hope and Crosby.
Hope and Crosby. Yeah.
Funny moments at the
How
movies.
Do you know all that?
That's well, the thing that gets me is man, so it's like people could come from all over the country.
Oh, it was wonderful.
Yeah. And
it
you was would the teach World these War, classes.
It was the World War II generation.
Yeah.
And at lunchtime, I'd have a class from 9 to noon or whatever. And then at lunchtime, I'd sit down with members of the class. Yeah. And I just met so many incredible people. I even met people who had worked on the atomic bomb.
Wow.
Part of the project, you know, flyers, bombardiers.
Jeez.
They came from just all, you know, Marines. It was just incredible.
But what's so cool is this guy says, he said that, you know, John, you have so much useless information. I think it'd be great for you to teach a class on all this.
Yeah.
And it's like, because and you had all this knowledge about movies. And so you're teaching these classes on golden classics of the silver screen and Frank Sinatra stuff. But didn't you feel like you could do what? I want to know.
You know what the most popular class was?
What?
Jewish comedians.
No.
Really? I can see that.
When the David called me up, he said, John, I want you to do a class on Jewish comedians. Yeah. And I said, David, I don't know anything about Jewish humor. No, you don't understand. He says, I want you to talk about the Jewish comedians you interviewed.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Okay, Jack Benny, for example.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah.
Milton Berle.
That's awesome. Sure. I mean, these are legends.
Yes, there were. I don't have the list of the names here, but yeah, they were all firsthand interviews. Oh, Rodney Dangerfield was a riot. I was just absolutely great.
Wow.
So I was able to go before the class and present things that they couldn't possibly have known from anywhere else.
But that's the thing, too, is like your background teaching. Yeah, the education that you're able to pass on. It's just, I mean, especially nowadays, just like with so much material out there, to be able to make people aware, younger generations aware of classic Hollywood and classic cinema.
I want to take your class now. I want to take that Jewish comedian class now.
Because
maybe you could do like another installment of like the more obscure ones, like Park Your Carcass, you know, or somebody like that.
It's important, John, because you may think it's useless information, but what you're talking about, all of this stuff, it's part of American history, too.
Yeah, it really is.
I think it's really important. You know, I have a 16-year-old, and my daughter has grown up learning about classic science fiction and horror stuff, and she's turned into a little monster fan herself, but she's watched the Boris Karloff and the Lon Chaney Jr. stuff. Wow. And so it's like I'm giving my daughter that education. I think it's important
that's
for
real
people
history,
like you, like you and us, to continue to let people know about our cherished horror history.
You're a national treasure.
One of the ones I remember most is Sid Caesar.
Oh, really?
Had been through hell.
Yeah. Really?
Despite all of his successes with his TV show of the 50s.
Right.
Yeah.
There was a drinking problem.
Yeah.
Right.
There were some drugs along the way.
Really?
And he wrote a book in which he pretty much described the truth. He told you the truth of his life. And during our meeting, I think we did two meetings, if I recall. Anyway, at the first one, here's a man, a comedian, telling me all this negative stuff about his wife, you know, everything, all the horrors he had been through.
Wow.
And I was able to share that, you know, so that you could see even Rodney Dangerfield, he had a very bad father who had been a comedian, but they hadn't gotten along very well. And yet, apparently, he had inspired his son to become what he was, a comedian.
Right.
And a very funny one, too.
Some of the best comedians have the dark side to them, you know?
Well, you know, what they say is tragedy plus time.
Yeah.
And sometimes you need a little more time.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, John, are you still doing the Rhodes Scholar thing? Are you still participating?
No, I did it for 17 years.
Yeah.
Wow.
Because if you ever come back, buddy, I want to go. I want to have a class.
Yeah, me too.
It got down to where the last year, 2013, I think I did 6 appearances in the whole year.
Right.
There just wasn't enough going on anymore.
Yeah. Right.
And I get the Rhodes Scholar booklet once in a while, and there's nothing here in the Bay Area anymore. David's Bay Area Classic Learning is gone.
Right.
Well, I just want to say,
if you find any San Francisco-based programs at all.
Well, if you ever decide to teach a class on American horror, whatever, I'm there.
Yeah, we're there.
But John, you've been working on some books. Can you tell us about what you're working on now? Is it The Career That Dripped with Horror? Is that scheduled to be released, or what? Where do you stand on that?
Well, I'm working with Dennis Willis, who's the Soundwaves fellow. You know, he has a TV show every Saturday night.
Mm-hmm.
Just before Creature Features on KOFY. Mm-hmm.
That's right. Yeah. I love that show.
Creepy Coffee Time.
Yes, I do.
Great stuff.
It's now a Creature Feature show that ironically is produced with the help of Tom Wersch, who brought Bob Wilkins and I back in 2000. He did the scrapbooks and we started doing DVDs together, tapes, and then eventually discs. And they have produced like 500 shows, I think, since 2016.
They're really fun.
Or no, maybe it's three or 400 shows.
This is the creature features with the Vincent Van Dahl.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so, Tangela.
Tangela.
Okay. So, Livingston, who's the big tall.
The butler.
Yeah.
Livingston cracks me up.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's funny.
But for listeners, if you're not familiar.
He was born in Germany.
Is that right? Wow.
Yeah.
Listeners, if you're not familiar with this, Creature Features is back and it has this different host, but you can find it on YouTube. Where they're showing these episodes and they normally have guests. And John, you've been a guest host a few times.
Yeah, I've been on the show, I think, 6 or 7 times. And
That's cool.
They try to have, writers or whoever's they can get to come over to do the show.
They're keeping the Creature Features spirit alive.
And I hope my new book will keep it alive.
Absolutely.
There's 25 pages devoted to the history of Bob Wilkins and I returning before the public.
Oh, nice.
Photographs of all the major players and some of the fans.
That's awesome.
Oh, nice.
Some of the fans became like, gee, they're here every time, you know. Here's the content.
Please.
Ray Bradbury and Robert Block both discussing exactly how do you write these wonderful stories. Adam West and Burt Ward, Batman.
Oh, nice.
Great.
Three Superman actors, Kirk Allen, Christopher Reeve, Dean Cain.
Wow. Oh, nice.
Wow.
Interview with Lois Lane, the threesome, Noel Neal, Phyllis Coates, and Terry Hatcher.
Wow.
Nice.
Stephen King, it was done in the early days of his success.
James,
whatever
happened to him?
You get some background on just how he got started.
Yeah.
Irwin Allen, who was the voyage to the bottom of the sea.
Yeah.
Master of disaster.
And time tunnel. Yeah. Turned out to be a real life horror story for me. I won't tell you what happened, but.
Oh, wow.
Do we have to wait for the book?
It's the one and only time I ever had a negative interview.
Really? I can't wait.
Do you remember Julie Adams?
Sure. Yes, of course. You know, met her
at a convention.
Did you know that she was, her legs were insured for, I think it was $150,000.
No, it was $1 million.
And they were considered $1 million.
It was $1 million.
And they were considered the most beautiful legs in the world.
And
I agree with that.
Here.
Listen to this. Julie Adams comes to the Castro Theater for a showing of The Creature from the Black Lagoon in 3D.
Nice.
And I'm to interview her up on the stage along with Ben Chapman, who portrayed the monster.
Nice.
And just all the land of creature.
Land sequences where he's walking along the land. So Julie comes onto the stage wearing a pair of pants all the way down to her shoes. You can't see any of her legs.
No.
Right.
Ben Chapman walks on the stage wearing a pair of shorts. All of his legs.
He switched around there. Yeah.
He lived in Hawaii. You know, he was that kind of guy.
Yeah, he was from Hawaii. We're correct. Yeah.
How much were his legs insured for?
It wasn't $1 million.
He passed away just not long after.
Yes, he did.
Yes. Yeah. Right. No. Yes.
Okay. We also have Stan Lee.
Nice.
I've got an interview with him when the first, at the time he thought they were going to do a Spider-Man movie. But then they did do a Spider-Man TV show.
Right. Oh.
Nicholas Hammond.
In the 70s,
the one that was the first Spider-Man.
Yes. Right. Yes.
And then I have Buster Crabbe, who was Flash Gordon.
Oh, wow.
That's awesome.
Max von Sydow, who played Ming in a 1980 version.
Flash Gordon. Yep.
We got the two of them. Also, I have, there were A to Z sketches in all of my movie guides.
Yes.
I took them by Ken Davis. I took a majority of them, I think around 60, and then we scattered them over 7 pages. I think it's a beautiful part of the book.
Cool.
Where you go from A to Z.
Nice.
Okay. So that's pretty much.
Is this book available now or how soon will it be available?
Chris and I are just in the process of finishing it up.
Okay.
Cool.
He's been pretty busy doing his television series, Soundwaves.
But John, let us know so we can let our listeners know.
I've got your emails and addresses, I'll inform you when the book is finally out. Yeah,
I can't wait. And just out of curiosity, do you think you might do an appearance maybe? So maybe I could come with my book and get you to sign it someplace.
I would like to be able to do that. I'll be in touch with Steve Wyatt. He puts on a lot of the shows that have been done in the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. He's from Bakersfield, but mm-hmm. throughout California.
Sure.
He does shows.
We'll make the drive.
And also, as soon as this pandemic thing dries up, Lord Bloodraw, who's a host.
He's a horror host. Yeah.
He puts on the Creature Features Con every year, the one that Tom started. Tom is more or less retired from that now that he's busy producing the KOFY show.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So those are possibilities for the future.
Yeah, that's dying to go to that.
Oh, we'd love to go.
Have to wait and see, what develops.
Right. Now, John, we have mentioned your shows, your books and stuff.
Thank you.
I know listeners, if anyone's interested, because there's a lot of stuff out there, if someone wants to check out a DVD of some of your old shows or some of your books, you can actually go someplace.
Oh, yeah. There's a website. A lot of the stuff, I've had to take down some of the stuff recently because it's sold out. Mm-hmm. But my website is www.stanleybooks.net. That's
so
it.
It's okay. Stanley, S-T-A-N-L-E-Y-B-O-O-K-S.
And you can order some of the older DVDs. Yes. You can order the DVDs. Most of them are still available. Creature@netwiz.net is my email address. You can contact me through that.
And prepare listeners to go back in time to the late 70s, early 80s. And it's just wonderful stuff.
Yeah.
Okay.
A delight.
That's wonderful.
Well, John, this has been great. Thank you so much. It's really been truly special. An honor to have you.
Yeah. Well, it's been wonderful to sit here for a couple hours and talk to you and to hear how much you love the show.
Yes.
And how you feel about it today.
Yeah.
Your inspiration.
It's nice to know that it really amounted to maybe more than a lot of people realize.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So many of you have remembered. So many fans would come up and tell us their memories and how they felt about it. And
that
was utterly amazing.
Our opinions and our love for this stuff so much. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Indeed.
And thank you, John, so much for everything you did. You really helped me grow up too, and I'm trying to keep this whole monster thing alive. So thank you so much, guys. What do you say we lift our glasses and give a toast?
Yes, right.
Let's give a toast.
Thank you,
John Stanley, and the legacy of Creature Features. John Stanley.
Thank you. Here,
keep America strong.
Yeah.
Time for listener shout out.
Shout out.
All right. That's a good.
One more. No, I'm stopping.
This goes out to Margaret Stevens from Alexandria, Virginia.
Margaret Stevens.
Margaret is now the proud owner of a Monster Party Classic logo glow in the dark t-shirt.
It's been mailed.
It's in the mail, Margaret.
Just now people can see you in the dark when you're stalking the street.
Stalking. Wow. Sheridan.
How well do you know Margaret? That's what I want to know.
I mean, like, you're stalking.
You really have a way with the ladies.
You're out there, like, you know, a monster fan.
All right. Thank you, Margaret, for being supportive.
Thank you, and forgiving.
Longtime fan and friend, Jim Jenkins from San Diego.
Jim Jenkins.
Has purchased two more t-shirts, which I think makes Jim officially the most prolific buyer.
T-shirt king.
He keeps this show afloat. He really does. Really. If it weren't for Jim, the whole thing would collapse.
Jim, we really owe you.
That's right.
Oh, my God.
I think, Larry, you have one?
Oh, yes, I do. I really, really do. Folks, I want to give a very special Creature Feature shout out to Ed Martinez.
Ed Martinez,
former special effects artist extraordinaire. I mean, Ed was instrumental in helping us get tonight's guest, John Stanley. And Ed, I want to say thank you so much. It was a
dream
come true.
Yeah.
And also, I want to give another special shout out to Dennis Willis, the technical guru wizard, who helped set John up so we could do this amazing. Yes.
Thank you, Dennis.
Dennis, thank you.
Good, yeah. Just good people.
That's yes. Right. Yes, indeed. But Ed, thanks again, buddy. We really appreciate
it. Yes, thank you very much. Yeah.
And if you're wondering about this aforementioned Monster Party merch, where you can find it, well, it's easy. You can find it on our eBay store, which is called Monster Party Store. Various sizes of our t-shirts are still available. Not all sizes.
As long as they're large.
And all sizes.
We have large
and, but just
and
large.
And large.
We're working on getting some more supply, maybe some different designs. And we are still working on bringing the Monster Party knit caps back.
Knit caps? Did you call those knit caps?
Knit, yes. Well, the knit is in the logo.
Those wool caps.
It's not a wool cap.
When I think of a knit cap, I think of like Michael Nesmith, you know? Like.
Well, no, you're right. It's a ball cap with knit logo in the front.
It's a ball cap?
Ball, B-A-L-L, baseball.
Oh, like a baseball cap.
Yes.
With several thousand individual stitchings for the Monster Party.
By the way, we might be missing out on an opportunity
to have a bald cap.
A bald cap where you can become Donald Pleasance.
Yeah,
all right.
Okay. Or Lex Luthor.
Right. Or a ball cap because sometimes you know they hang and you want to keep them tight to the body.
Yes. Yes. Sure,
that's great, Matt. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome, Larry.
That could maybe be another use for the Monster Party PPE face mask.
That's what I use it for.
Still available.
Yeah. But also, I want to point out that we, aside from the larges, we do have some assorted female sizes. But V-neck.
V-neck,
and we have medium and small. So we have a couple of those.
So check out our eBay store for that. And if you happen to be a Patreon member, we will also throw in special free goodies courtesy of Jason Lindsay and Biff Bang Pow Toys and creature creator extraordinaire Ted Haynes.
Yeah. Well,
really appreciate
good
contributions.
Stuff. Yeah. Yes, we do.
And so Patreon, Matt, what is this about Patreon?
Can you tell us about Patreon?
Well, you know, I've been
what
doing
is it?
This conundrum, this enigma. This Patreon.
I have consulted the Necronomicon and found out that Patreon is this platform that you can join that will allow you access to bonus things involved with our podcast. So you can get bonus audio, you can get bonus video,
video
exclusive only to Patreon shows.
Only to Monster Party Patreon.
For example, Larry's Toy Time.
What a classic show.
Shows you his toys.
Classic. And there's plenty more.
Yeah.
It's a big
Monster
collection.
Monster Party Masterpieces, which is, you know, examples of our old films that we did in the past.
Classics, Matt. They're
all
classics.
All of the masterpieces. As we said before, you will only be experiencing masterpieces.
Not on YouTube.
That's right.
Yes. There's a whole bunch more. But you might ask, well, how do I join? Well, you go to patreon.com, go to Monster Party, click join, follow the instructions. And next thing you know, kaboom, you are at ground zero of a blast of pure entertainment and pizzazz.
Now, sounds expensive.
It does sound expensive, Matt.
Yeah. Millions.
I don't know who you've been talking to, but I once again went back to the Necronomicon and I looked up Patreon, how much Monster Party.
Okay.
In the index.
Right, next to Yogg-Sothoth.
Yeah, right. And turns out it's only $5. $5 a month.
I spend more on chips each month. My God.
Dude,
I do.
You know what? I bet you do.
I do. Look at me. Matt, look at me.
You should cut yourself off at five.
Yes. It's the gluten.
It's the Monster Party diet.
How much is a Pringles tube? go for these days?
Well, $1.99, but I spend $1.99. More.
Okay, so you
get several.
You
can
buy the, you can get two tubes and then the small one. Or yeah, you can just go crazy. The little mini one, right.
Or you can forget about getting
the Pringles on the go.
You could just forget about your Pringles and just spend that money on Patreon Monster Party, and then you get a ton of stuff for the month.
That's right.
But if we could just get
Pringles for your ears.
Right. An endless tube that goes into your head, and each little wafer of delight.
Crispy delight.
That you put it in your mouth.
It's a chip.
Yeah. And it's a chip, but it's made. It's not like a regular
but
chip.
But it's not a wafer.
No, but those are naturally formed that way.
No, it's a processed chip, for God's sake.
Okay. It's a processed chip. But no matter what, if you're going to do Patreon, do the sour cream and onion.
Okay.
There's no sour cream and onion.
And you can never have.
There is if you want it to be. Glad I cleared that up.
James, was there something you wanted to say?
Yes.
Please.
Let's remind everybody that we are on social media.
We're the first to find out about this.
Yeah. What? We're with it. We're with the times.
We are hanging, man, with the kids. Yeah.
Oh, man.
They idolize us.
Yeah. They know all our handles.
The millennials idolize us.
We're on the Facebook, the FB, as the kids say.
Yeah, and we're gradually working toward getting on CB, radio.
This is great, but maybe we could let James talk so we can get to the information.
God, you are such a fucking buzzkill. Go ahead, James.
Our handle on the FB, otherwise known as Facebook, if you're not happy with it, is Monster Party TV. We're also on the YouTube at Monster Party. And we are on the Twitter. The Twitter hashtag at Monster Party HQ.
That's right.
Also on the Instagram.
Instagram. Yeah.
Instagram. You don't have to wait for a telegram. Just get the Instagram now.
Yes. Right.
And that is also Monster Party HQ. And listen, we would love to hear your thoughts. And we will read your thoughts on the air. So please take a minute. It only takes a minute. Write a review. We'd love to hear from you, even if you've already given us a review. Give us another one. There's no such thing as many reviews.
Yes. And if you provide us with a review, not only will we read it on the air, but we will add it as an extra page to the Necronomicon. You will now be part of one of the most famous infernal books.
Right. Excellent.
You're welcome.
That's wonderful. Wonderful.
Thank you, Larry, for your support.
Well, speaking of support, I also want to welcome back a new sponsor. Well, he's not a new sponsor, just an old sponsor, but let's welcome back Creature Features.
Yay! Creature Features.
Taylor White. Yes, folks, right. I got to tell you, if you go to eBay, check out their eBay store at C-Features. They have so many things such as books and CDs, DVDs, toys, autographs, all kinds of wonderful things. Yes. So check them out. And I want to. But they do have a slew of wonderful stuff for monster sci-fi horror.
We all own many things that we got from Taylor White.
Oh, so many
things.
All over the place. Good stuff, always. Quality merchandise.
Indeed.
And I got to tell you guys, if you check out some future episodes of Monster Party Podcast, we're going to have some special promotions, to Creature Features. So stay tuned.
I'm intrigued. On that note, I am Matt Weinhold.
I'm Sean Sheridan.
I'm Larry Stroth.
And I'm James Gonis.
Watch horror films. Keep America strong.
And celebrate the legacy of John Stanley and Creature Features.
Hey, guys, there's two witches fighting over there.
Fight, 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 fight. Look at that.
Can you hear me okay, fellas?
Oh, my God. You sound beautiful.
Yeah, you sound very good. It's a good mic you got.
We want to record at your place.
Yeah.
We'll be over in 10 minutes.
Hey, John, before we get started, just a couple things. Yeah. What we're going to do is Matt kind of introduces with a creepy voice. He kind of introduces our show. We introduce ourselves. And then we're going to say what the topic is. And you're kind of the topic. So Matt's not exactly going to give that away. And then I'm going to give an introduction where I say who you are. That's when we get started. Okay.
Okay.
And right. then the last thing is if for some reason we're going on and then you start saying, oh, that Pat McCormick, he was a jerk or something. And you go, oh, I shouldn't have said that. I'm just saying it's like we're recording this, but we're going to edit this.
So, yeah, so we edit it
nice and
yeah.
clean.
Yeah, I understand.
Oh, okay. It's not live.
Yeah. No, give me right. 30 seconds to alleviate one thing here.
I'm 81 years old. And
congratulations.
When you reach that age, there are moments when it's up here, but you can't recall it. It
takes sure, a long time
to come out.
And also, you know, I was telling some stories
to these fellows earlier today.
Yeah.
And like there were some names I couldn't remember.
And then none of us are spring chickens.
I brought a list.
Right.
Hey!
It has 800 names on it, alphabetized.
Wow. That's awesome.
It is the personalities I interviewed over a 30-year period.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Oh,
my gosh.
At the San Francisco Chronicle, primarily.
Just and read
a lot
them
of
all.
Them crossed over to Creature Features, of course.
Right.
Of course. Yes. Mm. And then the last thing, John, if we're going along, and, you know, because this will be at least 90 minutes, at least. If for some reason you go, you know what, guys, I need a bathroom break or something, you know, just let us know. And we won't include that. But it was
all right.
We'll stop and we'll come back. So those are the few things that I just wanted to point out.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, I'm wearing a diaper, so I'm fine. So.
I'm wearing no pants. So.
Yeah, well, that's what Sean does.
Cheers. I threw my diaper away a couple hours ago.
Start fresh is what I like to say.
Well, it's COVID time, so
yeah. Anyway. Okay, so we could start this at any point.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Okay, I'm so ready. Let's do it.
James, are you ready?
Dog leg.
Okay.
So here we go. So Matt,
prefer
I just
to jackass. That's all right with me.
Matt, I just want to make sure when we get to the topic, you'll kind of throw it to me, right?
You're going to say with it. Yes. That's correct. Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
So here we go.
All right.
Yeah.
One thing I did.
Yes.
I started this years ago. Mm-hmm. I started an A to Z list of fans.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really? Nice.
Yes. I have no idea right now how many names are in the list. But every time I would go to a show, I'd have a little pad. Mm-hmm. Here, write down your name and address of, or put down your email address or phone number or whatever you want to give me, you know. Mm-hmm. Social Security card or and so A to Z, I don't know how many pages they are. I've gone through it several times, sending out information to people when there's something new to, you know, promote. Yeah. But I'm so glad I did that.
And, you know, John, we didn't touch upon this, but it's like our love for movies. We all kind of went into the entertainment industry. We're all in the entertainment industry.
That's true. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, be sure you send me all of your emails. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure, yeah. Definitely.
Thank you.
And you will definitely get a response when the time comes.
All right. Beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank to all of you.
And
thanks
please,
for being loyal fans even today. Well, don't forget Soundwaves, okay?
Soundwaves, we'll definitely give you a big plug.
Just before Creature Features on Saturday night.
Fantastic.
Nice. Awesome.
Take a look at it.
Thank you, guys.
Cool. See ya.
One of the weird characters who's on it. And a beautiful lady named Shasta.
Ooh. I'm there. I'm in.
Yeah, you got to see.
You had me a beautiful lady.
Intellectual and beautiful.
All the things I love. And if you provide us with a review,
What have you been drinking this afternoon?
Look, heroin takes a while to get into your veins, and when it hits, woohoo! Okay.